Next, we have with us Dr. J.S. Rajkumar, who graduated from the Madras Medical College, Chennai with 32 gold medals. After that, he went on to do his post-graduation and got 4 FRCS to his credit. He is a prolific surgeon with a huge volume of laparoscopic and open surgeries in Chennai since 1993. He is also one of the international examiners for the Royal College of Surgeons, Edinburgh. He is the chairman of the Lifeline Group of Hospitals, founded by him in 1997. He was also responsible for setting up the first ever stem cell unit in Chennai and also for reporting the first successful case after stem cell therapy. He founded a trust in 1997 called Dr. Rajaratna Medical and Educational Foundation, by means of which he continues to render free service to hundreds of HIV and cancer patients. He is a recipient of several awards for his vocational excellence from organizations like Rotary, Lions, Public Relations Syndicate, Ved Vyas Trust, etc. From what I know of Dr. Rajkumar, I've always known him as a very active and energetic speaker, and to give away the inaugural address, which is going to be very, very powerful, welcome you, sir.
Thank you very much, ma'am. I want to start by thanking Sriram and Sujit and Shyam, the makers of this very, very well-planned one-day seminar. Congratulations to you too, Senthil. It's a very nice thing you've put together, and I hope that this sort of thing happens frequently. I'd also like to say thanks to Mr. Basant Krishna for that very good inaugural address and for the other very nice thing that he wrote. He didn't write the Bhagavad Gita or the Gitanjali. He wrote the check that supported the day, which is very important too. Thank you very much, sir. I want to start by saying that we are actually on the brink of an ecological and workplace disaster. Just as sub-Saharan Africa got wiped out by HIV in the early 80s, late 70s and early 80s, just as a lot of productive Germany got wiped out towards the end of the Second World War, we now face a very, very similar disaster. We are on the brink of a disaster, and we're seeing it, and I think we need health and wellness awareness initiatives like this beautiful one here put together by these few people. And I'd like you to stay with me for the next 20 minutes or 25 minutes, but I'm going to run you through a lot of data which is going to impact you directly, the people whom you work with, and thereby it's going to impact productivity overall at the workplace as well. Look at the current status of health. I just went through some of the health status demographics in India and across the world. And if you look at the people who work with you, look around at yourselves and at the people who work with you, most will be in the 25 to 45 age group. Some, like myself and Mr. Vasant Krishna, are blissfully a little outside the 25 to 45 age group, but this is going to be the biggest age group. I don't look it. I sure feel it. Are actually in this group, and this is the group, but I've written there, terrible. Because if you compare the 25 to 45 of today with the 25 to 45 of the 70s and 80s, our state is dreadful. Now I'm going to smash open a number of myths. I discussed this with Sujit, and he said anything that's straight off, which can be verified, you can tell people. You might be thinking that the average Indian lives much longer than the average Indian did in 70s, 80s. Very true. But I'm saying the average 25 to 45 health is much worse than in the 70s and 80s. That also is very true. So how come this happened? Because the infant mortality was terrible in the 70s and 40s. You know, in the 50s, 60s, 70s, many, many children were dying, and that was skewing the average age to a much to seemingly younger compared to what we are. But actually, those of us who survive childhood are much more now, and we have terrible health. Look at that, the next line telling you that between 1988 and 2000, there was a 70% increase in the prevalence of diabetes in this group in the city of Chennai. Let me just tell you, as a doctor, as a surgeon, to me it means all across the world, every 7 seconds, we cut off somebody's leg for diabetes. Every 20 seconds, one life is being lost for diabetes. And every 30 seconds, somebody is going on dialysis with kidney failure for diabetes. So the problem really is very big. It's huge. And if you look at yourselves, your families, the number of people who are suffering from diabetes, hypertension, and cholesterol, triglyceride, you know, you just walk around with it. These are silent killers. They get inside you and they drag you down. And this is called non-communicable diseases. And your group, the so-called organized sector, We're not talking about, you know, pure, you know, construction industry, which is quite unorganized, or bridge building, or which is a public sector. We're talking about the organized private sector. I'm putting in the first slide, these are the things that are going to drag down yourselves and your people. Huge healthcare burden, cancer is also on the rise, I'll talk to you about it in a minute, and of course, psychiatric illness. It's like the HR guy who went on a trip with his friends, you know, went to one pub, another pub, Friday evening, and then wakes up somewhere in some hotel at 1 o'clock on Saturday. Many of you might get into this situation. So he rings up his wife. This, I got this idea when I saw listening to Dr. Vasant Krishna. Rings up and says, "Have they phoned you? Don't pay the ransom. I've escaped." So that's a very useful thing. But then what you need to do is look at where you're heading. Where are we heading? The dangers ahead are that in the 25 to 45, already if you ask yourselves or in your companies, many people will be dropping down dead of heart disease. Either they will drop down dead, which is bad, or they will jump off the 7th or 8th floor. We've heard of a stray incidents, which is also very bad. And the next stage, they'll start pushing people off the 7th floor, which is equally bad. So these are all the dangers that lie ahead, and I think it's important for us to imagine and understand that to be forewarned about them is to be forearmed. What are those WHO indices of growth and development? If you look at between 2005 and 2014, India, Morarji Desai, when he was Prime Minister, somebody asked him, is India a forward or a backward country? And he said, no, it's an awkward country. And that is typical Morarji Desai. He used to answer every question with another question. When David Frost on BBC asked him, why do you answer every question with another question? He said, why not? So it's very typical. And you need to look at what is growth and what is development. If you look at India in terms of growth, we had more billionaires than any other, except Moscow. We had more billionaires than any other country. The number of people who bought Mercedes, Benzes and Porsches, maximum in Amritsar and Ludhiana, more than in Manhattan and in London. And you know, but so growth-wise, yes, maximum number of people in the high-income group, yeah. But development indices, number of people dying of communicable diseases, non-communicable diseases, India is still worse than Bangladesh and Sri Lanka and many of the African countries. So what is the answer? We have a problem before us. You guys are going to decide what the workforce with you is going to take on. And the answer, I think, is to adapt. You know, if you look at obesity, it's another major. I always say whether you're employees coming from Arunachal Pradesh up north or Andhra Pradesh down south, you look at Madhya Pradesh will start getting bigger after the age of about 35-40. Oh sure, when you guys join them, when they join you, they're 22 and 23 and everyone is slim, but not everyone continues to be slim like Sujit or like Sriram here, and you'll find that central Madhya Pradesh part will start growing more and more, and that definitely increases the incidence of heart disease. Look at this, man from the Cro-Magnon, Neanderthal man, went up to the second last, and then see what the last 20 years of burgers and pizzas and aerated drinks have done for him. So Indians are getting fat, obesity is swelling among our middle class youth. The main reason, if you ask me which is the biggest killer, if you ask me the biggest enemy to India today is not some jihadist, it's not China, it's not Pakistan, it is simply fast food. It's the fast food culture which is strangling us. It strangled the US, strangled the UK, it strangled Europe, and now it's strangling us. The amount of fast food, the amount of simple calorie sugars is actually killing us. Unfortunately, compared to America, I want you to carry home this message. Indians are more prone to dying early. And therefore, the fast food culture, which started giving Americans and UK people heart attacks at 60 and 70, will start giving us heart attacks at 35, 40. So to whom is it going to happen? To us. To you, to us, and to your people. Watch out. Fast foods are the killers. I'll be talking, my last slide is on initiatives. Wipe out fast foods from your canteens, and you'll start having a much healthier, more productive workforce. So we are going to survive. The next 15 minutes of my talk is, how are we going to survive in this environment? Charles Darwin very famously wrote in Origin of Species, it's not the strongest or the fastest. He actually wrote, it's not the fittest or the fastest that survives, but which creature survives? That animal that adapts itself to its environment. And now we have an adverse environment. We have plenty in the midst of poverty. And we therefore need to adapt. We need to survive. Look at the kangaroos. How do they adapt? Australia is the most arid country in the world. And you know how kangaroos adapt? They come into the shade and they just lick their forearms. The forearm of the kangaroo is very, very thin-skinned. The blood runs just under the skin. And when they licked themselves, they cooled their blood. And that's how kangaroos survived over centuries and centuries in Australia. So we need to be like the kangaroos, licking themselves to survive. Like the Bactrian camels in the cold Gobi Desert. Only ice. In the morning, the ice doesn't become water, it becomes vapor. So they actually eat ice at 4 o'clock in the morning before it vaporizes. And they eat small amounts and the ice becomes water inside the stomach of the Bactrian camel. So us HR guys, we need to become like the Bactrian camels and survive in the Gobi Desert, like the kangaroos and survive in Australia. We are on the brink of a disaster. Let's look at how we can change the productivity and morale. So what adaptation requirements are we going to bring on to combat this NCD disaster, non-communicable diseases disaster? 50s, 40s, 60s, people died of chickenpox, influenza, you know, smallpox, cholera. Now people are going to die of diabetes, cholesterol, and these are much more expensive deaths. So you need to make certain lifestyle changes. You need to make certain dietary changes. You need to make certain mindset changes. And you know, most of us, so beautifully said by Ralph Waldo Emerson, I think this applies to almost everybody in this room. Most of us spend money that we don't have, EMI, buying things that we don't need to impress people whom we don't like. You don't buy a Porsche to impress your father. You don't buy a nice posh house to impress your wife. Whether you come in an auto or whether you come in a Porsche, your wife is going to like it as long as you come back at 5 o'clock. But you want to impress the guy next door. You bought a BMW, I'll buy a Porsche. You bought a 2 BHK, whatever these things mean, I'll buy 3 BHK or 6 BHK or whatever. So I think getting out of that mindset itself, what we call mind over heart. And of course, when you say I'm in shape, this is not a shape. Round is not a shape. You need to start working out towards that. Oh, sorry. Okay, so what diet changes? What I'm going to tell you is going to affect your life. So write some of these things down. From today, go very high on protein. We'll talk about that later. Basically, if you're a veggie, take lots of legumes, lot of chana, lot of groundnuts, lot of mung dal, lot of parupu, etc. If you're non-veg, go on white meat like egg, chicken, fish, etc. Don't go for beef, pork. Go lower on carbohydrates. Very important to go this, you know, putting so much of rice on your plate, making one hole on top of it like Kilimanjaro, putting so much of ghee in that, then pouring some parupu on that, pouring some sambar, everything is floating about with oil. Go outside in this hotel, I'm sure you'll find paneer, butter, kumami, there'll be, you can put Australia, Africa, you know, the ghee and oil are floating about. Avoid that. Keep fats down. Go up on protein. Go down on carbs. Go down on fats. Go more on vitamins, go more on minerals, go on trace elements, simple things like nickel, cobalt, minerals and vitamins. You know, if I mention the measure the vitamin D in this room, at least 50-60% of us will be short of vitamin D. Because how many of you go in the sunlight and bathe like Saroja Devi? I find a lot of women, I thought they're like ninjas. They go like, you know, fully covered and everything is covered, fully in black, just the eyes are slit. I'm wondering whether they'll take out a sword or a shuriken or something. Maybe it's too, you know, most of them are pillion riders, so maybe the parents won't find out who's riding on the back of this handsome. But the net result is that they're actually going very low on vitamin D. And when you go low on, I'm saying be a ninja. Alright, and go down ECR with your boyfriend or whatever. But then take your vitamin D. Because if you don't take enough vitamin D, you have a significantly higher chance of breast cancer. In 2013, India's number one breast cancer in women became breast cancer and not cervical cancer. And one of the main reasons for that is having a low vitamin D. So now I'm going to talk to you later about customized medicine. What's medicine for her might be different medicine for him, based on their genes, etc. Finally, those of you who are free, try to read this fabulous book called Transcend by one of my heroes called Ray Kurzweil. Ray Kurzweil was one of the guys who started off believing in the computer. You know, Moore's Law, he believed in IBM, Intel, and he got a program called Transcend. It's called TRA. Read up this Transcend on the net. And he says that you can actually reverse aging. You can see his photograph when he started this program when he was 42. And now he looks younger than 42. He's got six packs. And, you know, it's the same fellow's photo. He lives in a ranch somewhere up in Indiana, one of the brightest, most intelligent minds on the planet. And he measures his own vitamin, his DHEA, etc., etc. So fast food versus street food. Have a look. You get 400 calories in traditional street food for 10 rupees, whereas you get 800 calories for 335 rupees. So on the one side, they're depleting your purse. On the other side, they're pumping your stomach up, and this is what will happen to us. So fast foods is a quick way of dying. So I need you guys to make lifestyle changes. When I said lifestyle, you know, my daughter asked me, Daddy, aren't you homophobic sort of thing? Well, I am, but it's different. Lifestyle is different from what I want you to do. I always, you know, when I talk on HIV, I say we moved from the days of Adam and Eve to the days of Adam and Steve. But here, the lifestyle changes are exercise. And when you say exercise, we know that even if your grandfather is 55 or 60, or your father is 60, ask him to take up some weights and start doing that. We know that if you challenge the muscles, we ask 50-year-old, 60-year-old women to hit the dumbbells. Because when you do that, do strength training, you'll have increased calcium deposition in the bones. They don't get weak, less chance of fracture. Men who do strength training as a routine tend to live longer than the guys who just walk up and down. So, and also this latest data, this year's data, Indians need 60 minutes of exercise 7 days a week. Europeans need 45 minutes of exercise 5 days a week. We have a much higher propensity for cardiovascular disease. Look around us. We're all going to be dead before our counterparts in the West. Look at the people who die. Just you go on the net and Google people who die early of heart disease in America. The number one group in that, Asian Indians. You put Indians who died in the 40 to 50. Patel, 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 Malhotra, Patel, Patel, Patel in the US. You know why? I think I know why. So I think that 60 minutes of any form of exercise, even walking up and down the corridor, you know, that beats watching 60 minutes of every mother-in-law trying to kill every daughter-in-law, every husband trying to kill every wife, every husband having 6 affairs with everybody, including the next-door neighbor who happens to be a man. You know, that's typical of our mega cereals. So I think mega cereals on one side are killing us, other side fast foods. And unaware of these two, we are dying in between. So you see, a patient is saying, problem is obesity runs in our family. Problem is nobody's running in your family. That's why you're all obese. It's nothing to do with obesity. Look at the mindset changes that I want you to have. Winston Churchill, at 94, look at his kind of thinking. There's a reporter who said, sir, we are celebrating in your 94th year. He was knighted around that time. And he said, I hope we all celebrate your 95th. I hope I'm there to celebrate your 95th birthday next year. Winston Churchill looked up and down at the reporter and said, I don't see why not. You look quite healthy enough to me. He had such a positive approach about his own health, and we need to go that way. We know that things like meditation, yoga, alpha rhythms, numbers or not, it's not important. If it comes back, then it becomes very important to us. You know, yoga, meditation, transcendental, all these things are very Indian. You know, from the Kama Sutra to the Tantric Yoga, we only have all the Kama Sutra written. It's all written by Western writers, and then we read it, though it all originated here. It's the same thing with Tantric Yoga, same thing with the Transcendental Meditation, Maharishi Mahesh, the same. So I think it's very important. Our Itihas tells us to stop and smell the roses a little bit. At least we're living in Chennai, you stop and smell at least the Kuam. But stop and smell it, you know, it's worth it. When you're running madly, you work to deadlines, and I must say that in the IT industry, I believe that the deadline, looking at deadlines is much more. We surgeons, we work to deadlines. You have to finish some particular operation by that particular period of time, or the guy can't take anesthesia, you know. So you're pushing, working against the clock, working to deadlines, and we surgeons have the highest incidence of heart disease. I'm standing in front of you as fit as ever, but I've had pretty severe heart disease myself because we're working to a lot of tension, working to deadlines, and that happens in the IT industry too. What happens is adrenaline is running for all of us. Steroids are running, and these two are very bad for your blood vessels. Whereas the guy whose photo is there, I was very jealous of this guy in your one day seminar on top. He's got this DHEA and growth hormone. This is the look of the man with a lot of DH, dihydroepiandrosterone. If you meditate, do yoga, don't work on deadlines, don't keep on looking, how hot is my neighbor's wife, how cold is my wife. If you don't do that, you'll be like this guy. Your DHEA level will go up. And your DHEA goes up, that's a happy hormone. It works with the pineal gland, settles the entire body. I think you should look at long innings. All of us, we study Sun Tzu, Art of War, fabulous book written in the 5th century, Chinese guy. He says, for fighting, he's telling the emperor, which we can all use in our lives, stay and fight by the river long enough, and the corpses of your enemies will come floating by. The idea is if you stand in there long enough, eventually you'll make it. No point in having a quick burnout, which is Indian style. Quick up and quick down. It's all over. So I think all of us must look at like the Sachin type of long innings. He started early, finished late, and we should all look at that. Now, this is something for you guys, for your healthcare. This is an important thing called the blood code check. If Indians must check these things, check your glucose, your triglyceride and your HDL. TGL and HDL is the fat in your blood. Look at the last three. None of us checks. I bet you.